Boa noite a todos e a todas. O Comitê Gestor tem a honra de receber os seus amigos para esta solenidade especial. No dia 31 de maio, completamos 20 anos de existência. O Comitê Gestor foi criado através de uma portaria interministerial em 95 e agora chegou à sua fase adulta, passou a adolescência, puberdade, e agora estamos na fase de responsabilidade total pelo que estamos fazendo. Isso que sempre fizemos com responsabilidade. Quero dar, então, as boas-vindas a todos os senhores e as senhoras, realmente agradecer a presença. E hoje estamos iniciando algo muito, muito, muito especial. Em 2009, o Comitê Gestor aprovou o seu decálogo, 10 princípios de uso da internet no Brasil. Princípios que para nós são valiosos, são muito importantes e que, de certa forma, marcaram a caminhada para chegar ao marco civil que foi assinado pela nossa presidenta no ano passado na NET Mundial aqui em São Paulo. E nós estamos iniciando hoje uma série de palestras. De maio a dezembro, teremos, então, em várias oportunidades, cada um dos princípios será um motivo de uma palestra com convidados especiais. E hoje estamos, então, iniciando essa série. E nós temos dois convidados especiais. A professora Liane Tarocco, da URGS, lá de Porto Alegre, e o nosso convidado do exterior, Steve Crocker, que é o chair do board de ICANN, veio especialmente para esta solenidade. Então, desta forma, estamos abrindo a nossa festa dos 20 anos. Estamos realmente felizes pelo que pudemos realizar até hoje, felizes pela presença de todos que estão nos acompanhando e anunciando que teremos, então, várias oportunidades para nos rever durante este ano. Em primeira mão, quero anunciar também que o CGI está coordenando todos os preparativos do IGF, que será realizado em novembro em João Pessoa. Coube ao CGI essa honra, esse privilégio de organizar o evento. E esse evento será fortemente influenciado pelas experiências acumuladas pelo Comitê Gestor. Nós temos uma série de trabalhos que foram aprovados pelo Comitê Internacional e essa cooperação plurissetorial, que o Brasil tem sido um exemplo, tem realmente trazido muito resultado positivo para o CGI e para nós como brasileiros, e é um orgulho, é um privilégio a gente ter esse reconhecimento internacional. Neste momento, então, eu quero convidar a Liane Tarocco, por favor, e o professor Steve Crocker, que assumam aqui, e que, então, os dois assumam e comecem, vamos começar, então, com o debate e com a palestra, por favor. Vocês entraram num acordo, quem fala primeiro, né? Ou precisa tirar para o ímpar? E already agreed who will be the first? Liane. So, Liane.
Bem, em primeiro lugar, eu queria dizer da minha alegria e satisfação de ter podido estar aqui hoje e me reunir com tantos amigos e colegas desta batalha que a gente tem travado ao longo dos anos para promover um uso da internet, seguindo esses princípios multissetoriais recém-referidos. Isso foi um esforço que o CGI conseguiu dar com mais vigor. Até então, as coisas vinham sendo feitas de uma forma um pouco mais amadora, e agora elas escalonaram para um novo patamar. Mas a fala que me pediram hoje para fazer aqui é sobre padronização e interoperabilidade, um desses princípios. Se vocês puderem colocar minha apresentação aí, por favor. Ótimo. A padronização e a interoperabilidade está, obviamente, intrinsecamente relacionado com o papel, com a missão do CGI, que é a governança da internet. Porque, se não tivermos essa preservação, esse perseguir de padrões, não haverá interoperabilidade, é claro, e os usuários ficarão reféns de fornecedores, de administradoras de telecomunicações, e terão que aceitar soluções que talvez não sejam as que atendam da melhor forma aos seus interesses ou que sejam oferecidas com uma boa opção de custo-benefício. Então, esses princípios, né, recém-citados, eu fico muito feliz que esse tenha sido o primeiro, porque eu acredito, batalhei desde o início da minha carreira como especialista em redes de computadores por soluções que fossem pautadas por padrões e não soluções particulares. Mesmo na academia, às vezes, a gente tem uma certa divergência a respeito do que é melhor. Do ponto de vista meramente acadêmico, uma solução inovadora, né, o clear state da futura internet, é mais atraente porque enseja realizações inéditas que vão ao encontro das expectativas de uma tese de doutorado e assim por diante. Mas uma abordagem mais evolutiva, como é aquela que pautou sempre o desenvolvimento da internet, tem se mostrado muito confiável, muito segura para os usuários. Então, essa opção de escolher um padrão, né, ela não pode ser uma decisão meramente baseada em critérios técnicos, porque há outros aspectos. Como se diz, a sociedade da informação, né, é a quarta onda, ela nos obriga necessariamente a trabalhar com padrões, porque, de outro modo, nós não conseguiríamos toda a interoperação entre sistemas. Das pesquisas que eu estava lendo, citou que um simples notebook com o qual nós trabalhamos no dia a dia chega a ter mais de 250 padrões ali, né, implementados. Então, no nível de mero processamento de dados, isso já era importante. O próximo passo vai ser muito mais crucial. Então, a padronização, ela tem, naturalmente, uma motivação do ponto de vista do usuário. Ele quer soluções padrões porque elas vão lhe dar mais opções. Eu compro desse e não daquele, porque o preço é melhor, e os dois interoperam com sistemas legados. Essa sempre é a grande expectativa, o que fazer com os sistemas legados. Eles não podem ser jogados fora, porque muito investimento foi colocado neles. Mas, naturalmente, tem vantagens e desvantagens, e os participantes dos processos de padronização têm isso bem claro. Eu já vou falar adiante sobre os papéis deles e as forças que os movem. Então, os padrões, eles podem surgir de formas diversificadas. Uma solução, digamos, fácil para uns, pelo menos, é quando uma certa tecnologia é adotada como padrão. Para quem fornece, para quem domina aquela tecnologia, naturalmente, isso é ótimo. Para quem usa, talvez até seja bom também, porque já é algo bem testado, não há surpresas. Então, vão seguir desse jeito. Mas pode acontecer que questões de propriedade intelectual, direitos de uso, entrem nesse jogo. E um exemplo bem claro disso é a história do padrão para o MP3, né, que o Fraunhofer Institute patenteou, e muitos softwares gratuitos que a gente usa para editar áudio não podem incorporar o conversor para MP3, porque eles teriam que pagar royalties para o Fraunhofer Institute. Então, eles têm que deixar sem a conversão para MP3 e dizer, ó, lá naquele lugar tem uma DLL que a gente baixa e faz a conversão. Então, isso é um contra-exemplo, digamos assim, dessa alternativa de padronizar uma solução proprietária. apesar de ela ser padrão, podem ainda se manter os direitos, né, propriedades e pagamentos terem que ser feitos. Normalmente, um processo utópico, ideal, né, de padronização, ele seria pautado por esse diagrama. Ou seja, mesmo os usuários finais teriam alguma forma de influenciar e dizer isso é conveniente, eu espero isso. Naturalmente, os fabricantes e provedores de serviços são os stakeholders principais, os intervenientes principais. Governo, né, entidades que representam grupos de usuários e outros, influenciam, então, os padrões que vão ser produzidos por esses comitês. Os principais intervenientes estão aí relacionados. E até, digamos assim, por ordem de importância. Fabricantes, como eu disse, prestador de serviços, normalmente são os que têm mais condições. Até porque definir um padrão é uma coisa que exige um conhecimento de engenharia, muitas vezes, especialmente nessa área de TI. Mas usuários também gostariam de influenciar, porque as soluções, ao fim e ao cabo, vão ser instrumento de trabalho para este grupo. Então, os processos de normalização, eles podem seguir duas principais linhas, a primeira e a segunda ali relacionada, onde a indústria traz suas ideias, seus padrões, às vezes suas soluções, e tenta transformá-los num padrão. A outra são os governos, que tentam fazer uma prospecção e dizer deveria padronizar-se dessa e dessa maneira para que as novas soluções tenham esta cara, este aspecto. E isso acaba criando aquilo que, nas revistas especializadas, eles chamam, às vezes, de guerra de padrões. Forças, né, se antagonizando, tentando influenciar os padrões. Portanto, um processo de padronização, como eu disse, não é só um aspecto técnico, há toda uma diplomacia, relações pessoais, um a um, que são estabelecidas no grupo, até a capacidade de apresentar, defender ideias e argumentos, influencia, às vezes, a decisão por uma ou por outra solução. A indústria tem um conhecimento técnico, mas sempre existe, né, o temor de que, bom, ela vai impor um padrão, mas isso vai ter um preço para o usuário final, né, de uma ou de outra maneira. Então, aquela questão que está apresentada no final, de se o governo deveria deixar para a indústria, que sabe mais como construir esse processo de padronização, é meio perigoso. Então, na verdade, a gente tem que considerar não só esses personagens, esses intervenientes, os stakeholders no processo de padronização, mas também esses fatores que influenciam o processo de estabelecimento do padrão. O ciclo de vida típico, conforme eu peguei de um excelente artigo de um pesquisador alemão da Universidade de Aachen, né, Kay Jacobs, então ele mostra esse ciclo de vida e a gente vê que tem processos aqui, requisitos iniciais, desenvolvimento de produtos, teste, e isso tudo envolve considerável esforço, tempo e recursos para que possa ser feito num prazo hábil, né? Então, a viabilidade técnica é, sem dúvida, um fator de peso, mas os outros três aspectos, políticos, estratégicos e sociais, são também importantes. E essa negociação, então, vai exigir uma intensa cooperação entre todos os intervenientes. Muitas vezes, a participação de um indivíduo em um comitê de padronização, ela é considerada como uma participação individual. Isso é especialmente verdade no caso do IETF. Claro, no caso do ITU, não, que aí a pessoa vem como representante de uma administração de telecomunicações ou de um país. Mas, mesmo no caso dos comitês ou os working groups, onde as pessoas estão ali como indivíduos, muitas vezes eles se veem como representantes dos interesses de uma nação ou de uma empresa. questionários, surveys que foram feitos com indivíduos participantes de comitês de padronização da ITU, da ISO e do IETF, mostraram essa realidade. Então, a gente percebe que não é só o indivíduo que está ali, altruísta e neutro, que vai labutar por uma solução ideal, né, ou idealizada. Então, as visões de cada um que participa desse processo, elas vão ter um impacto sobre o resultado final do comitê, é claro. Então, na verdade, essa seria uma situação mais realística, até como apresentada pelo Jacobs. E lá, naquele grupo, lá daquele quadro da esquerda, que são das pequenas e médias empresas, é o grupo mais desfavorecido nesse processo de padronização, porque, via de regra, esse grupo não tem representatividade, seja por falta de conhecimento técnico abrangente ou suficientemente profundo, seja por falta de condições até econômicas de sustentar a participação de um representante nesses comitês. Então, às vezes, existem associações de pequenas e médias empresas, mais organizações de consumidores. Por exemplo, em uma época, eu participava de comitês de padronização aqui no Brasil, representando a Suceso. Então, eu ia lá defender os interesses das empresas prestadoras de serviços de processamento de dados. Mas, na prática, o que a gente percebia é que nós tínhamos muito menos peso no influenciar uma decisão de padrão do que os fabricantes e os provedores de serviços. Especialmente dependendo da área, né? A gente tinha situações assim, onde se discutia, olha, essa solução não é muito boa, por isso, porque, ah, não, mas nós compramos essa solução, então ela vai ter que ser padronizada. Então, essas coisas, na prática, acontecem. O papel do governo, na opinião do Jacobs, vejam, também está aqui como uma linha tracejada, ou seja, muito pouca influência, apesar de que o governo pode fazer legislações, né? E tentar influenciar padrões. E um caso bem antigo e ficou muito forte nesse sentido foi dos primeiros modems, que tinha um padrão de modulação norte-americano, tinha o outro padrão definido pelo CCITT, e aqui no Brasil se usava o CCITT. Então, se a gente comprava, eu mesmo caí nessa esparrela, comprei um pequeno laptop em 83, e vim toda faceira para o Brasil com o meu laptop. Agora eu vou ligar ele. Ele tinha até um acoplador acústico, que eu comprei também. E, quando eu cheguei aqui, eu esqueci. Eu vi que não era compatível com o modem na outra ponta da linha, que era padrão CCITT. Então, essas coisas, né, acontecem, aconteceram no passado e vão continuar acontecendo. Bom, então, os participantes que a gente está aqui referindo e reforçando, um pouco mais aberto, envolve, no caso das empresas, tanto uma participação direta, ou seja, a empresa está lá, uma Cisco, uma IBM, estão lá dentro do comitê de padronização, insistindo por soluções, por determinadas alternativas. E um exemplo, mas também associações, bem clássico disso foi quando houve a padronização das redes locais, né? Apesar do o Comitê de Padronização I3E-802, então, ter trabalhado com aquelas três alternativas, CSMACD, Token Ring e Token Bus, CSMACD era mais simples, transmita e reze, a colisão não garantia confiabilidade na rede, tinha uma série de contras. Token Ring era mais seguro, garantia a confiabilidade da transmissão dos pacotes, mas tinha aquele problema, se cortar a rede física para a indústria, isso não servia, onde havia mais possibilidade de acidentes. Então, surgiu o Token Bus, o melhor dos dois mundos. O que aconteceu? O CSMACD logo foi implementado com soluções plaquinhas baratas, menos de $100 por uma placa de rede, e isso fez um boom. Também com o advento dos desktop computers, mini computadores, redes locais, dispararam. Token Ring continuou sendo a solução de ouro da IBM, e de ouro no preço também. Tinha um desempenho mais fácil de garantir, mas o mercado tinha medo porque a IBM tinha uma posição dominante e tinha medo de ficar cativo. E o pobre do Token Bus, que tecnicamente seria a melhor solução, acabou ficando no limbo e nunca disparou mesmo. Então, através desse exemplo, a gente pode ver que nem sempre a solução mais completa, mais elegante, mais complexa, do ponto de vista técnico, é a que acaba se impondo, por causa de todos esses fatores que influenciam, às vezes de uma forma até inesperada, o processo de padronização. Muitas vezes, uma grande empresa que tome uma decisão de usar determinado padrão e começa a fazer um teste, e o teste dá certo, mesmo que meio incompleto, ela influencia todo o mercado. As outras não pensam, não, essa já fez a avaliação, eu vou usar a mesma tecnologia. E saem todas atrás, mesmo que o seu contexto não seja o mesmo daquela primeira empresa. E isso... O quê? Não. Bem, então, essas são realidades que acontecem. As universidades, por sua vez, o mundo acadêmico, ele também tem um papel predominante, porque oferecem aquela visão neutra, né? Não está alinhado nem com a empresa A, nem B, nem com o governo, e podem dar um parecer um pouco mais distanciado, digamos assim, dos interesses econômicos que estão sendo envolvidos. E, naturalmente, nós temos indivíduos de grande capacidade ou que tiveram em alguma empresa ou numa instituição acadêmica ou de pesquisa e que têm, às vezes, as suas próprias empresas de consultoria e que também tem um papel importante nesse processo de padronização. Então, esse outro diagrama aqui mostra um pouquinho mais detalhado como é que essas forças externas, né, vão estar impactando a atividade dos indivíduos que estão lá dentro do working group e as organizações de padronização, né, são as SSOs, como elas estão influenciando, a própria participação delas influencia as decisões. No caso do ITU, não é participação aberta e livre. No caso do IETF, já é mais livre. As corporações têm modelos comerciais, né, e, principalmente, alianças. Né? Se uma empresa consegue, está labutando, está tentando impor um certo padrão, uma certa solução, digamos, proprietária como padrão, e ela consegue uma aliança estratégica, isso pode ganhar para ela. E um exemplo bem claro disso foi o CSMACD. Era a DEC Xerox que tinha uma solução do protocolo. Mas, no momento em que eles conseguiram a aliança com a Intel, que produziu o chip, barateou as placas imensamente, e aí eles ganharam o mercado. Eles tinham uma solução barata, estável, segura, porque eram duas empresas grandes que não iam desaparecer do mercado no próximo biênio, né? E o mercado ficou tranquilo e saltou naquela alternativa. Então, o desenvolvimento dos padrões de TI, eles são complexos, e é preciso que a solução técnica, por exemplo, que vá assegurar para a empresa maior capacidade de gerenciamento do que está sendo feito, do uso dos recursos, não seja a única considerada, em detrimento, às vezes, de uma interface mais user-friendly, uma melhor capacidade de atender o mercado. E, às vezes, nós temos decisões de compra que esquecem de olhar um pouco essas coisas, até por desconhecimento real, né, vivência real da experiência do mercado. Um exemplo disso, que eu vivenciei em particular, foi quando o videotexto chegou aqui no Brasil. O Brasil comprou a tecnologia da França, que era um terminal de telinha pequena, alfa mosaico. Então, os desenhos todos ficavam quadriculados ali, não era aquele smooth, como era o alfa geométrico, a solução canadense, e muito menos o alfa fotográfico, que era a solução japonesa. O que pensavam as administrações de telecomunicações? Nós temos o monopólio desse serviço aqui, nós vamos oferecer e todo mundo vai ter que se adaptar, dane-se. Só que quem é que ia prover o conteúdo? O conteúdo viria dos sistemas das empresas, os mainframes. Que todo programa online de teleprocessamento da época estava preparado para operar numa tela de 24 linhas de 80 colunas. Redimensionar tudo isso para uma telinha pequena não era um papel que um mero gateway externo pudesse fazer. Teria que refazer os programas em COBOL, PL1, Assembler, né? E isso não era factível. E por mais que, eu, na época, como representante dos usuários, tentasse mostrar essa realidade, eu digo, vocês não vão ter conteúdo para exibir no videotexto, porque ninguém vai montar um sistema à parte, separado, em massa crítica suficiente para que isso dispare. Acabou, né, o próprio sistema morrendo a míngua com o passar do tempo. Então, as possibilidades para uma empresa, elas estão essas duas soluções. E quais são as consequências? Deveria ter uma animação aqui. A empresa pode pensar que, se ela aderir ao movimento de padronização, todo mundo tem a mesma solução, é padrão, e aí começa uma guerra de preços e diminuem os seus lucros. Quem tem uma solução que é única no mercado pode cobrar o quanto quiser. Já empurrar uma solução proprietária tem a vantagem, vamos lá, de manter o mercado cativo, porque ele não tem alternativa, ele tem que comprar aquilo, e se o fornecedor disser amanhã, olha, aquele sistema agora está obsoleto, vocês têm que trocar esse aqui, que só nós oferecemos a capacidade de upgrade, né, tem que comprar. Nos dois casos, pode acontecer uma marginalização, no caso de lá, porque a empresa não consegue mais, digamos assim, ter lucro suficiente para se manter, e ela vai à falência, né, porque o mercado está muito competitivo demais. Já aconteceu várias vezes, né, no cenário internacional. E, no lado de cá, porque os clientes começam a se sentir, né, manietados, digamos assim, e começam a buscar alternativas, e acaba havendo um movimento de sair fora, pular fora de qualquer jeito. Acho que aquele movimento de downsizing que aconteceu num certo momento da história do mundo e do Brasil reflete um pouco isso aí. Eram os usuários querendo escapar de uma solução mainframe que era ditada por um único fornecedor e buscando uma solução downsize, onde o sistema operacional Unix permitiria comprar o hardware de gregos e troianos e fazer um trabalho. Envolveu muito esforço, mas foi um movimento bem forte. Hoje em dia, as coisas estão ficando mais intensas em termos de dependência de tecnologia. A internet das coisas está, né, à nossa volta. Segundo estatísticas, já existe hoje no mundo mais equipamentos, CPUs, do que pessoas, e isso em 10 anos vai escalar uma ordem de grandeza, pelo menos. Então, um carro que a gente dirige hoje tem, sabe-se lá, quantos processadores interagindo uns com os outros, já vem com 4G, já estão interagindo com o mundo exterior, e a gente vai estar sempre ligado. Redes de vestir, né? A computação de vestir é uma realidade, e isso tudo precisa de soluções padronizadas. Eu não me sinto, por exemplo, confortável com todos os artefatos que eu hoje uso, medidor de pressão, um contador de passos, nós temos lá num projeto nosso uma balança. Só a balança transmite Wi-Fi, os outros transmitem por Bluetooth para um iPhone. Então, é uma expectativa de que o iPhone vá se tornar o gateway, ou um Android, o gateway do futuro para esses dispositivos da internet das coisas. Mas será que a gente se sente confortável com essa solução ou gostaria de uma solução mais neutra, mais aberta, mais interoperável? Então, essa é uma área perigosa. Ups, deixa eu correr. Vamos lá. Então, as tecnologias, né, elas podem ter efeitos bastante perigosos na vida. Lembro do pavor que infestou a área médica quando, na virada do milênio? Todo mundo achava que os pacemakers, né, iriam parar de funcionar na virada do milênio. Era um pavor. Todo mundo que tinha um familiar que tivesse um marcapasso estava assim, né? Será que vai acontecer? O que será que vai acontecer? Então, esse é apenas um exemplo bem crítico dessa solução. Então, nós podemos ter movimentos reativos, correr atrás e tentar padronizar algo que, de fato, já está sendo praticado, ou, proativamente, fazer padrões para que as coisas a serem desenvolvidas funcionem de uma maneira que atenda aos anseios e necessidades da sociedade. É isso que eles chamam de conformação social da tecnologia. Isso que é importante permear todo o processo de padronização. Sistemas legados precisam ser preservados. Outro dia eu li que ainda há em alta no mercado a busca de programadores COBOL. Hoje, quem sabe COBOL paga a peso de ouro, porque os sistemas existem e precisam sofrer manutenção. Então, os impactos da tecnologia precisam ser estudados e dar uma olhada em alguns exemplos que falharam quando não deviam falhar no passado, pode trazer um insight para isso. Aquele caso do videotesco foi um, né, que eu citei, baseado no terminal. Esse aqui é um exemplo de tela, né, que aparecia no videotexto. A qualidade da imagem não era atraente o suficiente para usar como elemento de marketing, para vender, né? Então, isso foi prejudicado por uma escolha de tecnologia. No caso do Token Ring, que eu já falei, e o exemplo mais interessante foi o embate entre as duas soluções de correio eletrônico, o X400 do modelo ISO-OS e o SMTP. O X400 tinha tudo para ser a solução vencedora. Tinha todo o apoio do ITU, das administrações de telecomunicação, dos governos. Nós tivemos POSIC aqui no Brasil, né, GOSIP lá nos Estados Unidos. Todos os governos tinham uma legislação de que sistemas deveriam usar OS. Eu achava que era a solução. Escrevi um livro sobre isso, lá por idos de 83. E aí, quando eu fui fazer um estágio lá no SRI, uma amiga lá que sabia das coisas, Jake Feinler, me disse: no way, nunca isso vai suplantar o TCP. E eu defendi, mas é tão mais completo, tem muito mais funcionalidades, e eu era ardente defensora. Bom, o tempo mostrou que ela estava certa e eu estava errada. E o que que aconteceu? Por que uma solução mais completa, com mais funcionalidades, e que era uma necessidade do mercado, que o mercado estava pedindo uma solução que permitisse a interoperação de múltiplos sistemas de correio eletrônico. Então, o que aconteceu? Complicado demais. No 84, a primeira recomendação tinha 327 páginas. E quem já leu aquilo para implementar sabe que aquilo é um inferno, porque vai lendo e diz assim: aí a mensagem tem um cabeçalho que é composto de A, B, C, D. Ah, pode ser isso, aquilo, aquilo, aquilo. Sempre definições abstratas, nunca chegava numa definição concreta. Olha, os códigos que podem ir nesse campo é um que significa isso, dois que significa aquilo, e assim por diante, né? Então, um software muito complexo e que pedia o pilha OSI. E isso, principalmente, tornou ele, como eles chamavam, hostil à base instalada, porque teria que tirar a base instalada e implantar a pilha OSI. Alguns experimentos, principalmente movidos pela área acadêmica, até tentaram combinar o melhor dos dois mundos. Por exemplo, o ISO-DE, Marshall Rose, Steve Keeley, foram dois, né, ícones que trabalharam nessa solução, conseguiram colocar em cima do TCP, né, TP0, TP classe 0 em cima do TCP, a solução. Nós mesmos participamos daquele projeto Paradise, lá por idos de 92, e estávamos numa rede internacional de diretórios, podia consultar de cá para lá. Hoje, esse serviço evoluiu e o LDAP é usado para autenticar, né, no mundo inteiro, aplicativos, serviços, e até o serviço EduRoam, que nos dá mobilidade, né, no âmbito acadêmico. Mas tinha modelos econômicos, né, que o pessoal ficava também temeroso. Em o X400, passando a ser o grande sistema, de mensagens a ser usado como elemento de interligação, nós tínhamos aquela questão de como é que seria permitida a ligação entre sistemas de correio eletrônico de um país e de outro. As linhas cinzas mostram aqui possibilidades tecnológicas, mas as linhas pretas mostram que os PTTs queriam impor, ou seja, que toda a comunicação de um país para o outro tivesse que passar por dentro de um administrative domain e, é claro, gerar receita. Já o SMTP, não. Né? A solução que, desde o início, mais leve, né? Que levou em conta uma evolução tecnológica que o X400 não levou, os desktops, protocolos para uma solução cliente-servidor, que começou a ser popularizada a partir do downsizing, e funcionalidades que tinha no X400 e que não tinha no SMTP, acabaram surgindo quando o mercado começou a pressionar e sentir, como uma notificação de entrega, que ainda é opcional, e hoje, se precisa mais autenticação, para evitar os spammers, o SSH está fazendo um papel bem interessante aí. Então, a gente vê que as coisas não são totalmente incompatíveis, que, deixando aquele peso do modelo OSI, da solução X500 para diretórios, que era uma coisa que faltava para o modelo X400, houve uma evolução para uma solução que até hoje está sendo usada, que é todo um processo de autenticação baseado em sistemas distribuídos e diretórios. Concluindo, então, eu gostaria de ressaltar que, realmente, esse aspecto de padronização tem que nos preocupar a todos, como indivíduos, como organizações, como governo, porque isso pode influenciar as nossas soluções para uma vida melhor, ou até simplesmente para uma vida. Porque, na medida em que intensifica esses movimentos de smart city e soluções dessa natureza, né, as coisas começam a ficar menos e menos manualmente ajustadas e mais automaticamente, né, reajustadas. E aí, como é que isso vai funcionar? Com soluções proprietárias, caixas pretas, que nós não sabemos como internamente funcionam, ou com soluções que nós podemos abrir, auditar e assegurar que atendem aos interesses da sociedade. Então, essa era a minha apresentação, algumas ideias sobre padronização e interoperabilidade. Obrigada.
Thank you. It's a unique pleasure and an honor to be here. After listening to this presentation, I guess I have to tell you that I come from the lightweight side of the world. No presentation, and from a tradition of simple standards, as best as we can make them, and experimentation. This is the 20th anniversary of CGI, which is a governance group, a quite important governance group. I'll say more about it in a second, much that you know, of course. And I'm here really in two capacities. I'm currently, as you heard, chairman of the board of directors of ICANN, and we are all about governance, and we're all caught up in major discussions and evolution of our governance structure. You probably have heard that the U.S. government a little more than a year ago, announced that it was willing to bring to an end the contract that it has had with ICANN with regard to the IANA function that serves the entire world. And but they wanted some assurance that this was going to be okay with everybody, and that has kicked off one of the most intense discussions and dialogues that I have ever seen in my entire life. Thousands of pages, thousands of man hours, all kinds of controversies, and openness for everybody to participate. And it was still a bit open, a bit uncertain as to how all of that's going to come out. And what was supposed to be a relatively simple question of are we ready, is ICANN up and running, it's turned into a very, very strong questioning and challenging about ICANN's governance structures and so forth, most of which has very little to do with the actual question that was posed, which is, are we able to run the IANA function, which has been running perfectly for a long time? So that's one thing that brings me here. And the other is very simple. I'm an old guy, and I was asked to come and talk about the early days. So I will do that a little bit and try, maybe that will be a bit more entertaining than some of these discussions about governance. I'm going to talk a little bit about the technical stuff and a little bit about the interplay with standards. This is a very, very good talk. I enjoyed it very much. Always in the back of my mind, I'm listening to what's being said and reflecting on things. One of the phenomena that you can see in every venture related to networks is that it has to have a slogan. Every new company has a slogan. Every new organization has a slogan. ICANN's slogan is One World, One Internet. I guess I should ask, what is CGI's slogan? I should learn what it is. But the first slogan, the very first slogan that we made up at the beginning of the ARPANET was networks bring people together. And it was true even in the microcosm of the very small efforts that we were engaged in. When the ARPANET started in the late 1960s, it was started in four nodes around the western part of the United States. UCLA, where I was, University of California, Santa Barbara, 100 miles north of us in California, the SRI, which was about 350 miles north of us in California, and the University of Utah in Salt Lake City. The very first things that happened as we started to engage with each other was we went and visited each other, and in fact, that caused, as one might expect, the formation of relationships and some friendships, and some of which persisted for quite a long time. So the notion that network bring people together was not only at the professional level, but also at the social level. Having watched this group here, and similar groups that are reflecting back on their histories, I have to say celebrations bring people together as well. And so we have a process of building on what we've done to turn this into a very complex and very rich set of relationships that are built up over a period of time. The thing that I was asked to talk about was the early history, which I will do so, but also I want to pay attention to the early history here. Going back 20 years takes us back to 1995, but the history here, just as the history of the internet, goes back before the usual markers of what the, quote, beginning was. Things don't start all at once out of a... somebody sits down and says, oh, this is a great idea, and then writes a complete plan, and then all of a sudden it's off and running. There's a period of experimentation, there's a period of exploration and communication. So the what I'm told, and I apologize that I don't have firsthand knowledge of all of this, is that the real history here goes back to at least 1987, and that a series of meetings and papers and discussions and some experiments took place, including the formation of a critical team of people, all of whom or most of whom are here. My good friend Demi Getchko, Michael Stanton, Alejandro Grossgold, Alberto Gomide, excuse me. And Tadao Takahashi. Are all of you here?
No.
Four? Oh, that's too bad. But in any case, the point is that here's a period from 1987 to 1995 that represents a very important and rich part of the history here, but involved relatively small numbers of people, building the seeds of what would then spring into existence. And then by the time we get to 1995, we have enough information, enough people are aware, that we can begin to formalize those relationships and found the organization at CGI that has become so important and so effective. And its importance, I think, derives directly from its effectiveness. I mentioned that I'm part of ICANN, and we're very much concerned with internet governance, and one of the sources of inspiration for us is, in fact, the model here in Brazil. And we've tried very hard, actually, to point people in other parts of the world at the model here, because we think this works so effectively. Let me go back to the beginnings of networking that I was involved in. I mentioned the ARPANET was started in four nodes in the late 1960s. The decision process for building the ARPANET was really around 1967. But very much in keeping with the point that I was making about there were things before that, it didn't start from a single moment of insight saying, oh, we should build a network. There had been actually attempts to connect computers together for several years, many years prior to that. Most of these attempts were both limited in nature, and many of them were utter failures for various reasons. It's relatively hard to take computers that were not designed to talk to each other and to get them to talk to each other. From a technical perspective, there were at least two very big hurdles. One is the computers during that era were principally batch-oriented or single-purpose computers. And when you try to connect two computers together, the natural question of the day was, well, who's going to be in charge, and how do you get them to, even if you could get them to communicate, what would be the basis for what they were going to do? And the second big problem is that they were uniformly, all the different computers, were built to believe that they were the center of their own world, and there were no interfaces. There was no hardware access that made it easy to connect one computer to another. There was hardware interfaces, of course, to connect terminals, printers, tape drives, disk units, and so forth. But in every single case, it was a single central computer connected to a bunch of peripherals that were being responsive. And when you try to connect two computers, the question is, who's in charge, which is, how do you make one look like a device on the other? So with that, I won't go through all of the specific experiments, but there were a number of experiments, some of which are well known. By happenstance, I was part of a relatively expensive experiment on the campus of UCLA, which had the modest goal of connecting the three computer centers together, all of which were running the same kind of hardware. And it failed because of great political differences among the administrations of those three organizations, not because there was incompatibility of the hardware. In any case, the office in Washington, which is now called the Defense Advanced Research Project Agency, and before didn't have the first D in front of it, so it was just called the Advanced Research Projects Agency, but it was the same agency, had within it an office that was focused on advanced computer science research. And it had been funding research in the leading edge topics of the day, in graphics, in faster computers, and in interesting programming languages, in artificial intelligence, and in the development of time-sharing systems and so forth, all of which were having a fairly big impact. The And within that office, they had been watching the failed attempts at networking, and they knew quite well that one way or another, computers had to be connected. They had to be connected for a variety of different reasons, all of which were positive. Make better use of computers, perhaps, to help bring people together so that they could work together from across laboratories, to take advantages of differences in architecture so that you could have, for example, a large data store in one place and a very fancy graphics systems in another place. So with that kind of background, discussions started in earnest in 1967 and came to fruition in 1968. And led to the formation of this so-called ARPANET project, which had a couple of striking features. One was the computers that were going to be connected together were not of the same kind. That may seem like it was going to be harder, but in fact, it helped separate the issues because you didn't have to get involved with what one particular manufacturer was going to say about the way he wanted his computers connected. They also very cleverly said, we're going to build this network using the existing research sites that we have. This was a very interesting decision because it had a couple of subtle but very important results. One is they already knew who the users were going to be. They didn't have to go out and sell it. They didn't have to go out and twist anybody's arm. They effectively owned, for all practical purposes, these research sites. They were paying the budget, the cost of running everything on the site. So when they said, we're going to build this network using the sites that already exist that we're paying for, the people in charge of those sites had very little choice but to say yes. Now, it's not quite that simple. Some were excited about it, and some were excited in a negative way and say, why are you bothering me? We're doing fine research. We don't want to share our resources with anybody. And actually, that difference showed up in the choice of growing the network from the West Coast to the East Coast. It turned out that, by happenstance, much of the resistance that I describe was in the East and much of the warmth was in the West. Having grown up in California, I can tell you that California is a warm and friendly place, and so maybe that was all there was to it. But in any case, that was one of the decisions. Another subtle factor about all of this showed up in one of the most unusual management decisions that any of us will have ever seen. A fair amount of money was spent, and it was spent in a formal way through organized contracts, competitive procurement, all of the machinery of government procurement, to choose a contractor to design what we would now call the router. In those days, it was called the IMP, for Interface Message Processor. Bolt, Beranek, and Newman in Cambridge, Massachusetts, won the contract, and they did a fantastic job, I have to say, at designing them. Formal contracts were also put in place with AT&T, the dominant American telephone company, to provide the long lines, the leased lines that connected these computers together. A key point, of course, sort of a double key point, is that the idea of packet switching had become very attractive and compelling in the sense that one understood that computer communications were going to be bursty, and that when we get much more efficient use of the lines. And related to that was the idea of in fact, creating the notion of a router that is separate from the computers that are being connected. One could have imagined that you lay a line from computer A to computer B and from computer B to computer C and so forth, and burden those computers with passing messages through them onto something else. The interesting piece of insight was to remove that function from the host computers and create routers, just exactly what we do these days. Those were the base decisions that were made prior to building the network. The decisions that were not made were what we're going to do with this network. What protocols were we going to build? What applications were we going to put in? There was a little bit of discussion about it, but there was no firm decision. There was no program plan. There was no schedule. There was no assignment on these things. Instead, What happened is that the base part of the network, the routers and the lines, were put in place, and the sites that were getting them were told, figure out what you want to do with this. A very strange and, depending upon your point of view, either dangerous or brilliant result. Now, what actually happened is this. The sites that were receiving these nodes were, of course, as I said, major research sites, each of which was run by typically a senior professor who had an agenda and a career and had the budget and was in full swing doing his work and getting his graduate students to do the work. And now comes this message, you're going to get this network node. And they did exactly what you would expect. They said, that's not my primary task. They passed it down. And in universities, when you pass it down, that goes to graduate students. So graduate students or their counterparts in these different sites were tasked with this, with trying to figure out, what are we going to do with this network? As it happened, I had the accident of being in the right time and the right place. Vint Cerf, a longtime friend of mine and office mate at the time, was another. John Postel was also there. We got together with our counterparts, graduate students and staff members at the nonprofits, and had a conversation from scratch. There no agenda to speak of in advance, but we understood the rough outline of this network. We knew that there were going to be 50,000 bit per second lines. We knew it was going to be packet switched. And we didn't know a whole lot more because there really wasn't a whole lot more to be known. So we sat around a table in a small room at the University of California, Santa Barbara. And very quickly, we realized that we had roughly the same questions in mind. It was almost like a cocktail party where you meet people that you have rapport with. And we made one of the critical decisions that we were going to keep talking to each other. And to do that, we wanted to visit each other's laboratories. We understood on the spot the irony of that because the network was supposed to save travel money. And the first thing we did was start traveling heavily between each site. Very educational for us. And eventually caused a little bit of budget hiccup. And over the next several months, from August 1968 to roughly March of 1969, in a handful of meetings at each of our sites, we started to bat around ideas about what we were going to do with this network and what might be done. Some of the ideas were, I'll call the easy ones. You obviously want to be able to move a file. Obviously wanted to be able to move a file from one place to another. Obviously wanted to be able to log in as if you had dialed up from one place to another.
There's some water here, I guess, but I think I'm okay.
Thank you. But we also were deeply conscious that there were many, many, many more possibilities than those simple, easy applications, and that if we focused on simply getting those easy things to work and didn't provide, thank you very much, a basis for doing more, that we would have seriously lost important opportunities. So we understood that there were big things out there. We also understood that we didn't know what they were. This is a very awkward and uncomfortable position to be in. We could imagine some, but we were, as I said, we knew we couldn't imagine all of them. So we adopted a position that, in a positive sense, you might say was humble. I would say maybe we were just plain scared. We wanted to be very careful and cautious. So we said, we're going to put a few of the pieces in place that we think will be helpful. We're going to make a point of leaving room for others to build other things. And we're not even sure that the pieces that we're building are people are going to use. So if you want to go around it and do something else, that's fine. So I'm going to come back to that because that led to the architectural principle of openness. We also didn't have any ego about us being in charge of anything. we didn't view that we had any formal authority. We expected other people were going to participate. And yet there wasn't any structure imposed on us. Nobody came and said, you know, you have to report on this, or here's your schedule, or this person's in charge. So we were self-organized for these several months. And then in a meeting in Utah in March of 69, and so now we've been interacting for a little less than half a year, we realized that we should fulfill the natural obligation and write down some of these ideas. We're sitting around a table, we all know each other, we know who's been pushing one idea after another, and so we dealt out assignments. You write up what you've been talking about, you write up what you've been talking about, and so forth. And I took one of those assignments, and then I also volunteered for the trivial clerical task. I said, I'll organize these for us all. I took that seriously, and over the next couple of weeks, I kept trying to jot down what the organization of these notes were going to be, and every time I started, I stopped cold out of great fear. I thought, everything I can think of to write, I can imagine a negative reaction. Somebody's going to come and say, you're assuming authority that you don't have, who put you in charge, and a backlash. I'm in my early, mid-20s, and I don't yet have a PhD, and so, you know, I'm just disposable in the hierarchy, as it were. But I also was obliged to get this done. So after several tries, I found myself late one evening in a house where an awful lot of people were sleeping, and I didn't want to disturb any of them. So I'm standing up in the bathroom trying to crank this out at 3 a.m. in the morning, and I finally said, okay, these notes have no status whatsoever. They have no requirements for completeness. Write anything you want. They can be as short as one sentence. And they're not even publications, because we don't want to have to go through the publication review cycle that some institutions have. And to emphasize the point, I had this quirky little idea. I said, let's call them requests for comments, no matter what they are. Even if they're the most formal and massive document, we'll just, as a matter of form, call them requests for comments. And I thought it was a little bit of a joke, and that in a few months we'd have some formal documentation and these things would wither away. Didn't happen. What happened instead is that it took root and became the mode of communication across the network community. In those days, since we didn't yet have the network, every single thing that went from any of us to anybody else was a request for comment document. And among other things, we used the request for comment series to write down the mailing list that we were going to use. And anytime we added somebody to the mailing list, we created another request for comments. I have a large number of requests for comments credited to me, but if you actually look, several of them are nothing more than updating the mailing list. The RFCs number into the 6,000s these days, but that is not a comparable number to what we were doing back then. Since the network was built, we have email, and we have a subordinate class of documents called internet drafts that are intended to have short lifetimes, so that by the time we write a request for comments these days, it has been through an enormous sequence of messages and internet drafts and consensus process, and in fact, is not in fact a request for comment at all. It is shut up and read this. Still called a request for comments. And it's been tried to kill it off, and each time the discussion comes up, it's too deeply rooted. But I would estimate, it's hard to get an accurate estimate, but I'll just throw a number out, that the 6,000 RFCs today represent on the order of 600,000, 100-to-1 expansion, of the kinds of things that we were doing then. So the number is quite substantial. People ask me, among other things, what did you imagine when you were building the network? We had no trouble, I think, imagining how important the network was going to be. We had no trouble imagining that computers were going to be connected together. I could not possibly have imagined that the quirky little RFCs were going to live beyond the end of the calendar year that they were invented in. There's a lot of things that came out of that process. because of the way we started that and because of who we viewed we were and particularly who we weren't, we imposed no restrictions whatsoever. The documents were available free of charge to anybody. No charge. Anybody could write one. Anybody could have one. When we started to have meetings, the meetings were entirely open. Anybody could come. Over the years, that turned into what we originally called the Network Working Group and morphed from year after year and now is embodied in the Internet Engineering Task Force. And so you have a system of openness that has at least three pillars. One is the openness of access that I've talked about. Another is the openness of participation. And then getting back to the very first point that I was emphasizing, an architectural principle of openness that these new protocols that are created are optional and are built by anybody to work on top of whatever exists or to go around whatever exists. And so you have a very vibrant, very active process, still in process today. There are over 100 active working groups in the IETF today. One could ask, well, how could that be? Aren't the protocols done? The main ones that we use every day definitely are done, but there are a combination of improvements on them and creation of new protocols. And that leads to very peculiar and unanticipated results. We did packet switch voice in the very earliest days at Harvard, digitizing voice and trying to send it over the ARPANET. And it was clear that you could do that. It was clear that the economics were eventually going to be viable. But nobody would have predicted that the dominant provider of the protocols and systems would come from a small country in Northern Europe that was behind the Iron Curtain at the time that we started this in Estonia. Those kinds of things were just too hard to see. So those three pillars of openness, I think, have been extremely dominant. Another element that is related to the talk that you've just heard is the question of authority. The standards that are created in the IETF do not have the force of law, do not have contract provisions in them. They are technical contributions that have their effect, and they have great effect, because they typically work. So the process of bringing people together and hammering out consensus, and having watched the interior of that process, I have to agree that all of the kinds of forces that you've talked about, companies applying pressure and various other things, do take place, but the prevailing ethic and the rule is everybody is supposed to be there as an individual and that the technical quality is what's supposed to be the dominant rule. But the other element that is in that process is a pragmatism, a very deep sense of pragmatism, rough consensus and running code. So that there is a lot of emphasis on building things quickly, trying them out, and experimenting with them before making decisions that this is the final specification. So that process, which as I say, does not have force of law, does not have contractual force, has been the way that the IETF has developed. And in contrast with the existing, I'm not trying to throw rocks at anybody or criticize, but it has been, at least it used to be, perhaps it's changed, much faster, much simpler, and ran circles around the other kinds of standards processes. And so it was the case, for example, when the U.S. government was adopting the GOSSIP profile for OSI, that you could go into the offices that were grinding out massive documents about OSI on machines that were communicating with each other using TCP/IP, a very deep irony that you could actually buy products and they were using them and they didn't pay any attention to the fact that TCP/IP was in use while they were trying to say, and we're going to adopt OSI and it's going to take over everything. The game was over well before that. It's only a question of when. That's the sort of the main story. any number of useful anecdotes come out of all of this. A lot of experiments were tried, and some failed, and the ones that failed get buried very rapidly, and the ones that succeed just stay there. The early versions of mail were built on top of the file transfer protocol, and then it was decided that there needed to be a separate mail protocol. The mail protocol that exists today, I can tell you, is, from a technical perspective, ugly and error-prone. It is not something that any of us should be proud of, and yet our entire lives depend upon it. And that's been, at least from my point of view, extremely educational. I can tell you that I have to think about that when I sit in the governance meetings, which the discussions are sometimes outrageously off the mark and sometimes vicious in their personalities, and remember that that's not fundamentally any different from the compromises that we made in the technical arena, and so I just sort of relax and say, okay, well, we'll make the best out of it, and here we are. I don't know, I suspect I've used up as much time as desired here, so I'll bring this to a close. I do want to say that I have always enjoyed coming here. I consider it a pleasure as well as an honor. And I want to emphasize again that what has been done here in Brazil is truly one of the high points in both technical capability and in internet governance and governance of the internet processes here. Brazil has been a leader visibly, even visible enough that I can see it in the other side of the globe, in helping other countries get top-level domains up and running, and in an effort that I spent quite a lot of time on, the promulgation of the security extension, DNSSEC, for the DNS effort. Frederico, for example, has been an absolute godsend in terms of being helpful both around the world and in the region. And so my hat's off to everybody here. There is a reason why I think the world looks to Brazil and will continue to do so. Thank you.
Liane, muito obrigado. Steve, thank you very much. Temos tempo para algumas perguntas. Duas ou três perguntas do plenário. E eu provoquei o nosso coordenador, o Virgílio Almeida, para ser o primeiro a fazer uma pergunta. Temos um microfone para ele aqui? Como eu estava sentado do lado dele, foi fácil provocá-lo. Enquanto isso, vocês pensam em alguma pergunta também. Virgílio?
Pois é. Muito obrigado. Queria primeiro dar os parabéns aqui à professora Eliane Tarocco e ao Dr. Steve Crocker pelas duas magníficas palestras sobre a história não só de padrões, como a história da questão da invenção dos protocolos da internet, né? A minha pergunta talvez seja simplesmente para perguntar, baseado na experiência do senhor e também da senhora, quais são as sugestões que os senhores dão para questões como a privacidade, que é um assunto latente na internet nos dias de hoje?
Liane, você responde primeiro?
Bem, posso tentar. Eu acho que as soluções para a privacidade, elas têm que dar ao indivíduo o poder de decidir quanto da sua vida privada ele vai permitir que seja exposto. Isso é uma situação muito delicada, porque, por outro lado, falando como indivíduo, não como organização, as pessoas estão saltando na oferta de serviços gratuitos, sem ler os termos de serviço. Então, elas estão concordando em abrir mão de dados sobre si mesmo em troca de um serviço grátis. E, quando as pessoas fazem isso a nível individual, o que, que a gente pode, né, reclamar das empresas que estão fazendo uso abusivo dessas informações. Então, eu acho que tem que haver um trabalho de análise cuidadosa desses termos de serviço e discussão isso a nível do comitê gestor, para que se procure alguma forma de negociar com essas grandes empresas que oferecem esse serviço alternativas para esses termos de serviço que dizem, por exemplo, ok, vai mandar um e-mail para o nosso serviço e isso nos dá o direito perpétuo e irrevogável de copiar, traduzir, adaptar, fornecer para os nossos associados o conteúdo que foi repassado. Isso é, né, muito, muito mais perigoso do que outras ações que ganharam muita atenção da mídia. E eu fico, às vezes, surpresa com a falta de foco sobre esse tipo de falta de segurança que nós temos no país.
Obrigado, Steve. You have a comment?
Yes. First, I'll start off by saying that at ICANN, we have no control over content, no control over the services. We're very careful about the information that we accumulate. And so what I'm about to say has nothing to do with the posture of ICANN. We try to stay as far removed from this as possible. I want to cover a couple of things. I'm going to start with a funny little incident. My son, who I'm very proud of, is an attorney working for the Electronic Frontier Foundation in California, very concerned about privacy. He visited me one day and saw that on my Mac, the camera hole was not covered up. And instantly whipped out of his pocket a little stack of stickers labeled EFF and, with my permission, pasted one over the camera hole. And I understand his point of view, and I know what he's all concerned with, and I said, fine, that's good. And I left it there for a while. Some time passed, and I had to make a Skype call, and I moved the sticker out of the way, and I left it out of the way because even after the call, because I tend not to be as worried as he is about these things. A little more time passed, and I went into a meeting in at DARPA, actually, in the U.S. Defense Department. And they wanted to take my laptop away from me. I said, no, I need the laptop for this meeting. No problem. Somebody showed up quickly and turned off the Wi-Fi, turned off the Bluetooth, saw that there was a sticker available, and put that sticker on top of the camera hole. The U.S. Defense Department and the Electronic Frontier Foundation absolutely aligned. They want that. I made a point of telling my son, he said, oh, can I tell the woman who made the stickers? I said, tell everybody, you know, this is fine. The privacy is a complicated business. I say hello to you. Is that private to me, or is that private to you, or is that private to the two of us? And the trouble starts right there. You walk into your favorite restaurant, and you are instantly handed your drink of choice because you're recognized and remembered. Is that a violation of your privacy, or is that a service? There is an enormous spectrum, and we are a long way from sorting out what's acceptable, what's not only acceptable, but what's desired, who's being served for what. And there's clearly a lot of abuses, but there's also, it's even much harder than that, within any given culture, within any given society, one might try to find the right balance. But if one goes around the globe, I think we're going to find rather sharp differences. There are certainly countries where sending a message, the government says, we own it, we can look at it, and there is no discussion about privacy in the sense that we're having here. So there's going to be multiple clashes. There's going to be multiple clashes within each country, and there's going to be clashes across countries before we sort this out. I don't think it's going to be a quick or easy situation. And I welcome, and I think we should all welcome, vigorous but informed discussion of this, including the emergence of relatively common terms of reference so that When you interact with somebody, they, rather than sending you a lengthy contract that says, here's our terms of service and here's our new privacy policy, how many of us are ever going to read that? And much of us, how many of us are going to compare line for line what that says compared to the next guy? We need some, dare I say it, some standards. Now, by standards, I don't mean only one thing, but I mean a compact set of things that mere humans can understand. The typical estimate of how much a human can keep in mind is 7 ± 2 things in short-term memory. It would be delightful if statements about privacy and use were in a vocabulary that was shared widely enough that we could all understand. So that's a kind of non-answer about where this is going to go. None of us like to have our privacy violated. All of us like to be well served. The information that abounds in our transactions is enormously valuable, and huge investments are put into mining that data and using it, some for just straightforward marketing and some for much broader and more sophisticated kinds of things. So I think the only thing I could say is we ought to not trivialize the privacy discussion. It's an enormously important discussion, but also it has quite a bit of content to it.
Ok, thank you. Percival?
Esse tempo...
Fala em português, tem tradução. Okay.
Esse tempo de construção da internet que se falou aqui dos últimos 25 anos, pelo menos, basicamente houve um grande esforço no sentido de preservar, quer dizer, de preservar em padrões abertos, de manter interoperabilidade, de manter a internet coesa, por mais caótica que pudesse parecer as estruturas, mas caminhando para que uma unidade se formasse e chegássemos até aqui. Há indícios em algumas preocupações no sentido da fragmentação da internet. É como se... alguns princípios e algumas coisas que moviam as pessoas, que indivíduos se comunicavam com indivíduos interagiam com outros indivíduos. Hoje, grandes corporações interagem com massas enormes de clientes que não têm a mesma relação entre si, ou seja, desproporcional, às vezes, o papel de cada um dos players, dos agentes da internet. Será que a internet, aí é a minha pergunta, será que a internet chega num momento em que não cabe mais em si mesma? Será que a internet, essa rede, corre realmente o risco da fragmentação, de se transformar numa outra coisa que não é essa que nós lutamos até hoje, que vocês principalmente lutaram para que se mantivesse?
Fragmentation of the internet.
Yeah. It's a kind of a seesaw process that goes back and forth. There's enormous value in standards, in interoperability, in common things. There's enormous value in specialization and capture and dominance by individual companies. And these two things compete vigorously over and over and over again. You have it in the cell phone business with different protocols. You have it on the internet with sometimes different protocols. You had browser wars in which new features, it's still true, new features are added in order to, that only work with a particular browser, and then it's a question of whether that's going to prevail or whether there's going to be some copying of those kinds of things across. We've been fortunate, very, very fortunate, that common standards have prevailed and that attempts at closed systems have fallen by the wayside. They succeed for a period of time, and the term of art that we have is walled gardens. You get inside, and then you're in an environment that is controlled by people, and by that company, and then you do it their way, and life is nice if that's what you want to do, and then you have trouble busting out of that. Typically, the walled gardens have come down, and typically the standards have prevailed. But the challenge is there, and I can tell you from where I sit at ICANN that with respect to the domain name system, we worry quite a bit about the possible fragmentation and trying to keep the names namespace unified. And we don't rest easy about that because it's not a guarantee. But I think that is something to be vigilant about. And for any of us who have the power of specifying what systems look like, either as buyers or as users, I would strongly recommend as much openness as you can possibly insist upon.
Liane, algum comentário?
Eu entendi o ponto da fragmentação que o Percival colocou, mas o meu feeling é no sentido contrário. Cada vez mais nós vamos estar imersos em uma internet que não apenas vai estar tendo conectado dispositivos convencionais, mas nós vamos vestir, nós vamos ter dentro do corpo, nós vamos ter no carro, na casa, e tudo isso vai ser uma internet só interconectada. Que, como eu vi outro dia, um dispositivo que tem na roupa, que se a pessoa cair, um movimento brusco, é um sensor que já vai disparar um alarme, que vai ter que avisar um e-mail para alguém, para vir socorro. Quer dizer, não vai servir uma internet que não seja totalmente interconectada. Então, embora vai existir essa dicotomia de uso, né, massivo para a extranet das empresas, ainda assim, eu sinto que, cada vez mais, tudo vai estar interconectado, os sensores, a internet das coisas, com os sistemas convencionais, e a gente vai estar imerso, né, ligado. Nós vamos ser, pessoalmente, um nó da rede.
Tem uma pergunta do nosso ex-coordenador, Augusto Gadelha. Por favor, Gadelha.
O Stephanie, ele mencionou de que tinha um grande interesse realmente hoje na área de segurança. Eu acho que essa questão da segurança da internet é o ponto-chave do futuro da internet. A minha pergunta a ele, principalmente, a Liane é muito bem-vinda também comentar sobre isso, é quais são as perspectivas de nós termos no futuro uma internet realmente mais segura e em vista, inclusive, de que toda a nossa vida hoje depende da internet, né? Na área comercial, na área bancária, na área e assim por diante.
So you've touched a nerve here, because I care very much about this, and I think I'll take you down some pathways that may surprise you. Before I get into the interesting part, when we talk about security, we're really talking about a whole bunch of different things that fit under the same umbrella. Does it mean that my computer is not penetrated by people from the outside? Does it mean that the traffic that is passing from my computer to some other place is not being read or modified? And does it mean that the mail that I get is from parties that are authentic and that I know who they are? So that's just the beginning of a fairly long list. So one caution when we're talking about security is that it subdivides into a large number of separate things, and it's easy to get a room full of people that are talking past each other. There's a lot of money at stake with respect to copyright infringement, and it's not too hard to get a room full of people, some of whom say, we have to take down these sites because it's a security matter, and what they really mean is they don't like the fact that they're copyrighted material is being sold or made available without paying proper royalties. One element that I care quite a bit about is whether the base structure of the internet is up and running or has the potential of falling apart or being interfered with. About four years ago, 2011, I became aware of this is a true story, and it's got a little bit of details in it, so bear with me. I became aware of a bug, a software bug that had been discovered in what were the current versions of Bind. Now, Bind is the name of the software that runs most of the DNS in the world. 80 to 85% of the resolvers and authoritative servers is the estimate. Now, the bug was not in every version of Bind, and there are an awful lot of versions of Bind because it keeps being modified and changed. It was only in the most recent ones. And so the logical understanding is that this bug would not be actually evident across the entire network, but only in a small fraction. But nonetheless, it was in the then current versions of Bind. The nature of this bug was the following. A single packet, one packet, sent into the DNS server or resolver on the standard port 53 would cause that system to crash. Crash means that it's out of service and it does not supply answers to queries after that until it's restarted, and there's no standard restart mechanism. So that's the bad news. The good news is, well, it wasn't a naturally occurring packet. It was one that would have to be very specially constructed. And it was found by, as an accident, of some very sophisticated measurement mechanisms that then led to an investigation as to what the interior structure of that version of Bind was. But nonetheless, the possibility was there that you could take you could construct what that packet is, send that packet to an IPv4 address on port 53, and if that was running that version of Bind, lights out, game over. That would be very unpleasant for the people who are dependent upon that version of that Bind DNS server. It'd be very unpleasant for the people who are running that server and providing service to server. And for people, I don't know what the mix here, but just to make sure that everybody's on the same page, DNS is at the heart of every single transaction that we take that takes place. Every time you type a domain name, like www.nic.br, that has to be translated into an IP address, and that translation takes place by a series of queries that happen at quite high speed that tear that apart into its pieces and go to a server at the root level if necessary to find out where the answers are for the BR level, which then goes to the servers that will tell you what the answers are for the NIC.BR level and so forth, and finally cough up an IPv4 address. And these, as I say, these transactions happen very, very quickly, and they're the inside of everything we do. So if the DNS service is down, then you're out of business. Now, as I said, a single packet would take down a particular server, but imagine what happens if somebody says, well, why don't we just try this on all of the IPv4 addresses? There's 4 billion IPv4 addresses. Not all of them, of course, are running DNS. It's possible to do a survey in the background and find out which ones are running DNS, and you'll get some numbers of millions, perhaps. You could then say, as a thought experiment, what would it happen if I sent that particular packet, this killer packet, to each of those few million addresses? How much work would that be? Not much work at all. A few seconds, a few minutes, whatever. And all of those would then die. And now you don't have a bad day for the people running that particular server. You don't have a bad day for the people who are using it. You have a bad day, period. Millions of people displaced from the internet. Internet down around the world. Film at 11. Well, they don't say that anymore, but that's what the news would be. Congressional hearings scheduled Monday morning. So Dr. Crocker, you're chairman of the board of ICANN. How'd you let this happen? Aren't you in charge of security for the internet? No, well, okay, so just security of the domain name system. It says here you try. How did you let that happen? What do you mean you're not in charge of the software? Who is in charge of the software? Bad news. Not a scenario that you want to contemplate. Didn't happen, of course, but the scenario did go through my mind. Next thing that went through my mind was, well, suppose something bad did happen. The first question I'd be asked is, and who did you tell? And on the strength of that, I did actually pick up the phone. I called two people in the US government, and because the bug had been discovered in the UK, there was a parallel coordinated call with a corresponding official in the UK government, just to alert them that a bug had been found that had this extreme possibility that this could happen. And then all of the usual mitigation factors went into place. Patches went out, people running important servers were notified, et cetera, et cetera. The people that I called, just to tell you what the level of this was Howard Schmidt, who was the cybersecurity czar for the White House, and Larry Strickling, Assistant Secretary of Commerce, who oversees, whose agency oversees ICANN. Timing was awkward. It was the 4th of July, which is Independence Day holiday in the U.S. I happened to be able to reach them by cell phone, and we had very short but positive conversations. And as I say, nothing bad happened. Almost everybody involved in these discussions and the incident treats this as this is sort of the sort of thing that happens all the time, and we have our processes in place for notification, we have our processes in place for getting patches out quickly, and we go back and look at why that happened in the code, and we try to make sure it doesn't happen again. I participated in all of that, but I had a different thought. My technical background, aside from working on the network, goes back. I'm a dyed-in-the-wool mathematician and programmer. I grew up with math, and then did a lot of programming when I was young, and did my research work on formal correctness of software. And I turned away from that quite some time ago, but this incident caused me to think, why in the hell is it the case that software with those kinds of bugs gets out in the field? Why does it leave the desk of the programmer? And it's not a question of taking to task whether or not there was clumsiness in the work. It's not a question of whether there was discipline or process. We know that humans are involved in creating the software, and we're not going to make a large change in the quality of what humans do. We are going to make a large change in the quality of what computers do. We have Moore's Law working on behalf of us, giving us a factor of 10 every 5 years. On the computer side, if you try to measure what is the improvement in humans, you're going to get 0.0001% over 100 years. Not going to be where the leverage is. But the question that went through my mind is, why is the technology for creating software has not improved over 40 years to eradicate the simple bugs? There's lots and lots of very subtle things. There's a lot of deep theorems about you can't, there's undecidability and so forth. But for the class of bugs that bedevil us, that cause the vast majority of the holes that lead to these security holes and lead to zero-day problems and so forth, and then generate an enormous industry of patches and reactive kinds of things, firewalls and virus checkers and so forth. Why aren't we putting the money into, and why aren't we making progress on catching these things as part of the thought process before they leave the programmer's desk? So that's a question which I actually have started to put a lot of energy into. There is a lot of progress in the technology of theorem proving and other related things, but it has not yet come together, and we have not yet gotten to the point where it has made a first-order difference in the way software is produced. But we can. I think we can. So that's probably not the kind of answer that you expected. There's a lot of other things that one can talk about, but I think that if we shift our attention in terms of where we, what we demand, we'll be better. One small point about this. If one looks at hardware, at computer processors, it's surprising, but it's true, that there have been mistakes in computer arithmetic from the very beginning. There's a literature you can read about errors in the way different computers were built. It didn't bother people very much. I mean, it was sort of a minor thing along the edge, until one day Intel had a processor that had a very minor bug in its arithmetic, and the world went crazy. How can you possibly have an error in your arithmetic? It says Intel inside. And then the first thing Intel said, well, it's not very big. It doesn't matter very much. And, you know, and if you really care, we'll give you another processor that's fixed and so forth. Not good enough. $2 billion they spent to replace those processors. And we know Intel is a very reputable company, and they put a lot of work into getting it right. This was not because they were careless or didn't pay attention. I know something about the technology that they use in their design process, their testing process, and so forth. And this is not for lack of trying. They put even more money into it. They have better processes these days, and I'm sure that this sort of thing won't happen again. But the world went through this change in focus. Said, how can that possibly be? It's just unacceptable to have those kinds of errors. Suppose we got to a point where somebody discovered a bug in the operating system, and the reaction was, what? A bug in the operating system? How can that possibly be? Something has gone terribly wrong. We're not there yet, but one could imagine getting to that point.
Liane, algum comentário em relação à segurança? Não. Eu estou vendo que tem uma pessoa tá assim mostrando vontade de fazer pergunta. Ivan, faça a pergunta que você está ansiosa para fazer. Professor Ivan Moura Campos, nosso primeiro coordenador do CGI. Microfone para ele, por favor.
Não, eu vou voltar ao passado, porque o período do Steve lá na UCLA com o meu teve um overlap. E eu queria que ele contasse brevemente como é que foi o trabalho que resultou na sua tese de doutorado e no desenvolvimento das primeiras versões de protocolos nos IMPs da Bold, Beranek e Newman.
And so you're asking about my work at UCLA, and we were colleagues way back when with a really fine environment at UCLA, I have to say. One makes a lot of mistakes when one's young. one makes a lot of mistakes even further along. I shocked each of my children separately when they look at me as a successful person, and you know they're all struggling through their various stages. And I said, if I were going to write my autobiography, the title of it would be Salvage Operation. It's just one mistake after another. When I got involved with the ARPANET project at UCLA, I had to set my sights on doing my research in formal proof techniques. And then because I had a fair amount of experience with operating systems and system software, and because this looked like it was useful, and mainly because I was undisciplined and easily distracted, I let myself get involved with this ARPANET project and the design of the protocols and the organization of the social processes, getting people organized around it. Now, my thesis advisor, Jerry Estrin, was a fantastic guy, very warm, very nurturing, and correctly diagnosed that if he had tried to tell me what I should have known, which was that I should have taken the work that I had done on the ARPANET and written it up as a PhD thesis, I would have finished my graduate work in a much shorter period of time. It would have been useful to the world, and that would have been the disciplined and organized thing to do. He didn't do that because he knew full well that I was not listening, and that it wouldn't have worked, and that I would have just sort of been annoyed with him. So what I did do is I worked on the ARPANET, and I even took a further digression and went off to work at the funding agency at ARPA itself for a few years, and then insisted on coming back and doing the formal methods proof work that I wanted to do. I developed a proof technique for looking at machine language code, for looking at very low-level code, and for very accurately modeling exactly what that code was going to do and being able to prove properties about that code. And finished that work and then continued afterwards getting some funding and doing some more research on that for several years. Funding in that area turned out to be tough in those days, and over time I gravitated further and further back toward networking. There's an intersection between the formal proof stuff and security work, and so there were kind of a couple of steps in between there. the piece of code. And so to do work like that, what you do is you you make up a formal system for reasoning, and then you have to build a proof system that is automated and that can handle those proofs. And then you take an example, and you actually go through all of the pieces of trying to do that. And I took a very tiny example. I thought just a starter thing, which turned out to be all that I could do. I took a short sequence of 8 instructions that were actually in the IMP, just the lowest possible piece of code. And all that code did, for those of you who are technically trained in this thing, is it allocated one buffer off of the free buffer list for an incoming packet. So it was just 8 instructions that took a linked list and delinked one packet and closed it up and so forth. And the instruction set in that machine is very rudimentary. It's a small machine. And the most powerful and complicated instruction in the machine was an exchange memory with accumulator. It just swapped two places, one in memory and one up in the CPU. Another kind of instruction in that machine was add one to memory and skip if zero, which is typically used for loop control. But there was an instance of that instruction buried in these 8 instructions, and it wasn't for the purpose of loop control. It was the purpose of counting how many times that code had been entered, and it was for measurement purposes, for just sort of counting the frequency of which packets were being allocated. I looked at this code, and I'm thinking through, how do I prove that this code is going to work every single time under every single condition? And I looked at this this counting instruction. I said, well, what happens if it actually gets to the point where the counter gets so high that it wraps around and becomes zero? It's going to skip the next instruction, which is one of the 2 exchange instructions in this code that is absolutely central for the integrity of this linked list. I said, that won't work. And yet, now I've got a problem. This code has been in the system working for 5 years at that point, and I did rough calculations as to how often this bug was likely to show up, and it looked like it was going to show up once or twice a day in every IMP across the entire network. I said, well, that can't be right, because a bug of that magnitude would surely have been found. And it took me a while, and I actually had to ask for some help. Why was that not a bug? And the answer turned out to be because there was another piece of code running in the background that sampled that, sent it off to a measurement center, and then zeroed it back down so that the counter didn't overflow. And now my problem of trying to show the code is correct is not just the simple thing of what each instruction is doing, but I have to show that that code in the background is going to run often enough and doesn't get starved for cycles. And now I've got to know what the speeds of the machine is, and I have to know how fast packets are coming in, and I have to know the size of the lines, and perhaps even whether it's running on a 50 or 60 cycle clock, depending upon which part of the world it's in order to show that that background code is going to get there in time. And now the complexity of proving even that tiny, small piece of code is just outrageous. I can tell you now, because they can't take it away from me, that I simply said, assume that it's not going to overflow, and I went on with the proof and so forth. But there is complexity in trying to do this. It's hard. And there's an interplay. I don't know which of these things you were trying to draw out of me, Yvonne, or whether I missed it completely.
No, that's fine.
Yeah.
You answered it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Steve, thank you very much. Liane, muito, muito obrigado. Uma salva de palmas. Essa foi a primeira conferência de uma série de 10. Então, 9 outras seguirão durante o ano. Nós manteremos vocês informados e convidando. A segunda, logo no começo de julho, teremos como convidado do exterior Frank Larue. Ele virá para estar conosco aqui também numa conferência. Agora, quero convidar todos para um coquetel, até umas 8h15 aproximadamente. Aí nós vamos entrar num outro ambiente e ter uma parte mais cultural, uma parte musical, e depois ainda mais uma última parte de compartilhar a nossa amizade e celebrando, então, juntos os 20 anos do Comitê Gestor. Obrigado pela presença, todos convidados para o coquetel.